A baby is a potential.
All right. This is the first workout. You're gonna do it right. This is your warm up. Let's go.
Oppression seeks to hold that down, to limit you, to stifle you, to control you, so you don't reach your potential. So you're stopped from maximizing your divinely ordained reason for human being. It involves restricting your God-given human potential so that it can stop God's plan for your life. It's called oppression. Now, oppression can take many forms on many levels. There is political oppression. You find this in dictatorships or military governance, where a particular dictator, in order to limit the power of others in the name of a political order, it's Russian communism under Lenin, that Marxist way of life, where walls are built to hold people in and to stop them from being able to move from one place or another place. It is to hold them or contain them, to limit them. There is economic oppression. This is where the rich hold the poor down, keep them in classes so that they're not able to express themselves, get free to develop their own entrepreneurial spirit. It's where they are limited and they're stuck in ghettos, not because that's where they want to be, but that's where the system has forced them to stay. Economic oppression. We're all familiar in the United States of America with racial oppression, where people are held down because of the color of their skin, and the color of their skin prohibits them access to that which the rest of the society has free access to simply because how they look. There is domestic oppression. You often see this when a wife or a woman is so controlled by a man because of the threats of violence. I was sitting in my office one day and the husband and wife came in for counseling, and it became clear what the problem was, which had not yet been verbalized, because when the husband raised his hand, the scratch his neck jumped. So it became very clear very quickly that this woman was living in fear. She was under the thumb of a dictator who, falsely using the biblical word submit, was actually using God's way to oppress. Parents sometimes are oppressive to their children. That's where child brutality comes in, where the children are terrified. Because the parents don't spank to correct. They spank to hurt and to bring harm.
Let's pray.
It's all oppressive. It's all holding people down. Some of us grew up in oppressed homes. When we were told we were nobody, we were never going to be anything, we couldn't expect to be anything, we were dumb. And so whether you were physically brutalized or not, that thing...
This is how you work out. The best routine
and it became
for the ass.
Oppressive way
you better believe it, baby.
And looking at yourself. You know when people have been affected that way, because even when there's nobody surrounding them to oppress them, they oppress themselves. Self-oppression. All designed to stifle your potential and your God-given future. Then, of course, that's the worst kind of oppression of all, spiritual oppression. That's where the devil has his way with your life. He's telling you, you gotta stay on these drugs. You gotta stay in this alcohol. You have to stay in this relationship that's doing you no good. You have to stay there. You can't break out. This is your lot in life. And you've been living with that spiritual oppression so long, you've been different. You believe you were born to be oppressed. The Bible says Jesus came to set the captives free. That oppression is not to be your middle name. That oppression is not to be the state that you live in. It's not to be how you operate. That you have been freed by creation. simply because you're human, and then even more so by redemption, because you are a child of God. In the passage we're in your hearing today, Israel is being held hostage in Egypt. Verse 23 of Exodus 2, now it came about in the course of those many days that the king of Egypt died, and the sons of Israel sighed because of the bondage, and they cried out, and their cry for help because of their bondage rose up to God. They were in bondage. Remember, freedom is released from illegitimate bondage. What happened? Well, if you look at chapter 1, verse 8, it says a new king rose in Egypt who did not know Joseph. The people, the sons of Israel, they said, are more mightier than we. Come, let us deal wisely with them, or else they will multiply. And in the event of war, they will also join themselves with those who hate us and fight against us and depart from the land. So they appointed taskmasters over them to afflict them with hard labor. Verse 12, and the more they were afflicted, the more they multiplied, they spread. Look at 13, the Egyptians compelled the sons of Israel to labor vigorously, and they made their lives bitter with hard labor. The end of verse 14, which they rigorously imposed on them. Notice the words, imposed, compelled, bitter, afflicted, taskmaster. They were being bound, they were being forced. They were being driven. Why was there oppression? Because the oppressor did not want them to be free. The oppressor said, if we let these people go free, they'll become too strong. That's what he says. And that's what oppression always wants to do. It wants to limit you becoming strong. It wants to limit what God can do in your life.
This is how you get those ass, baby.
And so it begins to work its insidious evil in order to stop
this is how you get
realizing your maximum potential. See, that's how
higher
you
kick.
Have to look at this thing. You have
kicks
to look
have to become at least way high. Waist high.
It's trying to
kicks must come at least above the weight level. Okay? Round 3, ready start. 3-minute round. Let's go.
Which has to do with maximizing your potential under God. God has redeemed you for freedom. But the problem was, there was an evil king who did not want them to be free, who wanted to keep them hostage. And I'm here today to tell you, freedom is your middle name. And that I don't care how long you have been oppressed. They have been oppressed for 430 years. I don't care how old you are today. The day is the day of your freedom. Whether it's self-imposed freedom, freedom by somebody else, freedom even in a culture, unless you understand that oppression in any form is against the will of God, no matter how legitimate it's been made sound by the oppressor. God's gift to you. God's gift to you today is freedom. What did the king want? The king of Egypt wanted to use the children of Israel to further his agenda. What does the devil want? To use you to further his agenda. What he doesn't want you to do is to find out what God's got in store. He doesn't want you to further God's agenda. He wants you to further his agenda. And he knows if he can hook you up on something that now controls you. That's why Paul says, I will be controlled by nothing. You can be led by people. You can be led by things. But once something is controlling you, it has taken over God's place in your life. And the Bible has a word for that. It's called idolatry. Nobody is supposed to be able to control you, okay? Folks can influence, folks can lead, folks can direct. But they're not supposed to be able to put their thumb on you so that you define you by them rather than by what God has created you to be. It says that the people groaned in chapter 2. They sighed because of their bondage. Because oppression has a way of crushing the human spirit. It causes the spirit to just die, to just shrivel up. And you see it You can see it on the face of a child who's been oppressed by a parent. You can certainly see it on a wife who's been oppressed by a husband. You can see it in a man's eyes who's been oppressed by his employer, who's been made to feel like nothing. Now, I don't know if you are just. You're supposed to be a free gentleman. See, it's got nothing to do with how much you make and what your title is. And that's why nobody has the right to your spirit but God. Now, they may want to crush your spirit. They may want to tear down your
that's
spirit.
9 minutes.
See, that's why
and
it's
how much
very
I'm sweating.
Important that you know that God tells you you're free. Because if you don't know that God tells you you're free, then other folks will define
30-second break.
And will be given permission.
Yeah, baby. That's how you work.
It's not only that you're oppressed, but that you give the oppressor permission to keep oppressing. Because you don't know who you are. If I have a gold ring on and you don't like it, you ain't me. So you don't get to tell me what it is. It's gold because the manufacturer said it's gold. Now, you say, well, that ain't gold. Well, if I don't know what the manufacturer said, and I'm listening to what you tell me it is, I may not think it's gold anymore because I've given you more power than the one who made it. But as long as I can go back to the receipt and I can see that the man who made it said it's gold, it really don't matter what you think it is, whether you like it, whether you agree with it, because I've been told by the one who made it that it's gold. Well, guess what? The one who made you see you. The one who made you defines who you are and defines who your reality is. So they were under oppression for all of this time. They were being held down. But then it says, verse 23, Daniel chapter 2, it came about in the course of those many days that the king of Egypt died and the sons of Israel sighed and they cried out. That means they had not been crying out until the king of Egypt died. Oh, it says, when the king of Egypt died after many days, then they cried out to the Lord. Which means they had been under the oppressor, the king of Egypt, for an extended period of time prior to them crying out to God. In other words, they got used to oppression until the king died. As long as the king was alive, they didn't like it, but they accepted it. When the king was no longer there to enforce it, they remembered God. You see, one of the things you need to understand, because the king, remember, in Egypt is the government. And it amazes me how much Christians look at the government to be surrogate God for them. And you know we do it because we want the government to do everything.
Hello?
But he said, the king was the oppressor.
Tonight.
The king was the one holding them down. It was only when the king was no longer there that they remembered that there was a God bigger than the king. Because the king had obscured God. Now, I ain't trying to get political, although I could. But the Bible is clear that the government should be both limited and taxes should be low. That's the biblical principle. Government limited, taxes are low. You cannot be free if you're not also willing to be responsible. You got a teenager in your house and they want to be free. They want to be free from mother and father and rules and regulations and got to be home at 10 or 11 or 12. I want to be free. Okay, are you ready to pay your bills? See, if you demand freedom, you are at the very same time demanding responsibility. Don't tell me you want to be free, but you want to be irresponsible. That's a contradiction in terms. God told Israel, he said, when you get to the promised land, don't more manna from above. On the wilderness, I'm gonna rain down your blessing. When you get there, pick up the shovel and the pick, and you pick up the oxen and pick up, and you plow the land. Because freedom demands responsibility. So we got folk waiting for God to drop stuff from heaven when God has said, I thought you wanted to be free. That means you take ownership and responsibility in order to enjoy freedom. You can't enjoy freedom and be irresponsible at the same time. So the more, getting back to political, the more you want the government to do, the less free you're asking yourself to be. Now, that's not a popular thing. That won't get me voted for 9/11. So it don't matter. He says that when the king died, when government was no longer to handle this situation, they now are remembering God as covenant. It says the covenant that he had with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They remembered God had something to say about this. What did God tell Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? God says, I'm going to bless you, and through you, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. Think of it. And I'm going to curse those who curse you, and I'm going to bless those who bless you. So it dawned on them when they remember the covenant. God said he was going to curse those who curse us, because we're his covenanted people. Egypt has been cursing us. We bondage and oppression. But God said if they curse us, they curse him. You ever had a big brother fucking messing with you and you said, well, you have some cousins. Violent brothers. In other words, you remember you have somebody bigger than your father. God says in the Abrahamic covenant, I'm going to curse those who curse you, bless those who bless you. You cursing me? You cursing God? Hey! If they cry out to God, they remember the covenant. You see, what oppresses me? Oppresses have something. And the thing that oppresses does not want you to have the information. See, oppressors try to keep, that's why oppressors are people trying to keep them uneducated. Because they know if they get more knowledge, they're going to discover that they got the right to be free.
That's what you see.
They want to keep you ignorant. They want to keep you uneducated about the realities that are yours. You see, they want to forbid you to get an education or equal education. They want to hold
five rounds, 3 minutes.
Informational.
15 minutes.
If you don't know, you can't go.
There you go. All right.
The Emancipation Proclamation was signed.